Writing this book has been very challenging for me. It has made me revisit my past, and it has been an emotional but therapeutic experience. This book is an account of my traumatic early life up to the age of 19. Every single word of this book is true. The hospital account, the appearance of social services, and being back in Nigeria alone, every word is true. I was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder. This makes me withdrawn and I find it hard to trust other people. I also spend a lot of time alone in my room. I grew up in the shadow of my grandmother. I was born in Lagos, Nigeria on the 16th of October 1992. I was the eldest of four girls and two boys. After I was born, my father ran away because my grandmother disagreed with the marriage of my mother and my father. One day, the year I turned 3 months, my mother took me to live with my father. 2 months later, my grandmother found where my parents were living and took me back to Lagos with her. A year later, I found out that my parents had had another three children and they were all living happily together as a family. 3 years later, my parents had a fight and divorced. My grandmother went to visit my mother and persuaded her to come back and live with me in Lagos. After 1 month, my grandmother started beating my mother up. My mother's brother was also a victim. My grandmother told my mother she must go and marry another man. I had a difficult time living with my grandmother. Indeed, so did the rest of my family. My sister and I were hardly ever allowed to go to school on time like other children. My grandmother expected us to do all the housework and we would often be beaten by our grandmother, who had become even more violent and abusive. My grandmother disapproved of my mother and discouraged her from coming to the house. My grandmother often became angry over small things, like because it took me longer than she expected for me to carry out a specific task. She would often beat me and my sister and accuse us of witchcraft. She would say, "Like mother, like daughter." When I was 14 years old, I moved to my maternal auntie. This was because my auntie had recently got married and I was supposed to help her with her baby son. She promised to send me to school. Within a week, my reality was helping my auntie with her childcare and other daily household tasks. I was again subject to a regime of abuse, beatings and accusations of witchcraft similar to what I had suffered at the hands of my grandmother. One day my auntie told me that I must not tell anybody else in the family that I was not going to school. She threatened to beat me if I did, although I never told anyone and the beating continued anyway. I usually followed the family when we went to church or carried the shopping bags when they went to the shops. I was not allowed to stay at home by myself because my auntie believed that I could calm the family and she said she did not trust me. One day my auntie and her husband told me that they were taking me and the family to the United Kingdom and told me that my reason for following them was to get a good education. I was so happy. I thought, I will be saved. There will be no more abusing. I'll be treated in a proper way. Because you cannot compare England with Nigeria. In England, children are respected, I thought. But in Nigeria, people abuse children and treat them any way they like. And also, they have power over them. Each country has their own way of life. Before coming to England, I was told not to inform my mother because my auntie said that she did not trust her. But later, my auntie informed her herself, telling her right at the last minute that we were due to leave. My grandmother never told my mother, and we flew from Lagos to Heathrow, arriving on the 26th of November 2007. When we first came to England, we stayed in the house of a woman. We stayed there for less than a month. There was a day, while we were still living at this woman's house, when my auntie began beating me, accusing me of stealing her money. Throughout, the sister of the woman we stayed with begged my auntie to stop. There was another occasion. My auntie was in the habit of giving me money to hold for her because she didn't want her husband to know she had it. On this day, my auntie accused me of spending some of the money. She beat me and called me a witch, saying that since I had moved to live with her, all her children had been falling sick. After some months, we moved to an address in the north of England. My auntie's husband and their three children and myself were in the household. At night, my auntie and her husband went to work, leaving the three children for me to look after. This was nothing new. Since my early years, I'd looked after a three-month-old baby. I was like a childminder for my auntie's children. Sometimes I didn't get to bed until 2 in the morning because I needed to get the house clean and make food for my auntie's family. You might wonder if I had any good experiences with my auntie. The truth is, I do not know, because the abuse has overshadowed any good that may or may not have been done. Even now, the scars are a daily reminder of what I suffered, and whenever I see them, I feel sad and withdrawn from people. They make me feel broken, like I need to be fixed. I'm receiving counselling at the moment. This has been so difficult to write because the more I write, the more tearful I become. While I'm writing my story, I remember Baby P. This case made me so sad, realising that child abuse is still happening and still goes unnoticed. Baby P motivated me not just to write as therapy for myself, but to also make my book available globally for the world, to help people see that child abuse is a serious issue that needs to be dealt with. Hopefully, it will be a learning tool for social services, police, and parents and carers who have responsibility for children. I need to tell my story in the hope that it will help to stop the battle and child trafficking. Does anyone really know the damage caused to the mind of a child that has suffered abuse? An innocent child may be lost before their story is heard. As a result of trauma or lack of love, a child may decide to join a gang, where they receive a false sense of love and belonging that their family never showed to them. Such neglect can begin a cycle, the scale of which is hard to quantify. At home, no one spoke to me. I was shown no care and no love. I was completely on my own. On most school days, when I got home, my auntie and the family were out, so I used to sit at the foot of the steps outside in the cold, waiting for them to return. Sometimes they wouldn't come back until the following day. Sometimes when I was waiting for the family to return, a couple that lived opposite would see me waiting in the cold and, I believe out of compassion, would beckon me to come into their home to stay with them until my family arrived. But I always had to refuse, because if I went into their house, my auntie would have beat me. There was a church member that gave me a phone and some clothes. My auntie reported me to her husband, and her husband asked me what I'd told the lady. I was ordered to stand down. This kind of corporal punishment requires you to bend down on one leg, and with the other leg lifted up, you place one hand on your back, using one finger of the other hand to touch the floor for balance. I had to stay balanced like this for at least 40 minutes. I did this punishment to the extent that my nose was bleeding. Another bad memory. When we were in Nigeria, my auntie asked me to take her daughter to a salon to do her hair, and my own hair too. The salon was busy, so we were asked to wait. But later we had our hair done. By the time we got home, my auntie was so mad at me. She thought I was late. I wore my hair with rubber bands in it and had just had it redone. She used my hair to pull me up and started beating me. After that, I was asked to kneel down on a grater and told I must balance for 30 minutes to avoid a beating. I had received a kick to the back of my head and my tummy from my auntie's husband's brown boots. I was in such deep pain I could not answer the questions my auntie's husband continued to ask. After the beating had finished, I was so sick. I had tummy pain, but I didn't dare say it out loud. In 2008, I was enrolled at Our Lady's Catholic College. Although it was explained that I would have to buy a school uniform, my aunt refused to pay. Eventually, the girlfriend of my aunt's husband's brother agreed to pay for my uniform. I was able to start school. School was a nightmare for me, because I was expected to do as much work around the house. Around 4 in the morning I had to get up to clean the house, cook, then get the children ready for school. This meant that I was often late for my own school. I needed to leave my own school around 1 p.m. to collect the children from their school. At the end of the day, I had to be home no later than 3:40 to avoid a beating. After returning home, I was expected to be in the kitchen cooking and doing the cleaning. This really disrupted my time at school because I was constantly arriving late and leaving early in order to avoid problems at home. One Tuesday at school, there was a parent-teacher meeting. The next day when I went in, one of my tutors saw me sitting down, all quiet. He walked over to me and said, "Are you all right?" I said, "Yes, I'm all right," and he walked away. Later he came back and said, "I thought there was something wrong. What happened? I didn't see your parents here last night." I was quiet for half an hour, because he kept insisting on asking me. Eventually I broke down into tears and he took me to the head teacher's office. I was crying and scared. If my aunt and her husband found out that I had told the school, I didn't know what would happen to me. But the head teacher was concerned, so he called social services. When social services came, the lady asked what had happened, and I told her. The next day, the social services lady went to my aunt to ask them about what I'd told them. Later, my head teacher took me home. When we got there, my aunt and her husband pretended like nothing had happened. The social services lady took me to one of the bedrooms upstairs and asked me what I wanted to do. But back then I had no understanding of social services and how they could help me, so I told her that I didn't want anything. I was young and scared. Soon after, both the social services lady and my head teacher left. The lady from social services never came back. In 2009, one incident happened over money. My aunt was angry and accused me of destroying her family by reporting them to social services. Later, I learned from a friend of mine that both my aunt and her husband were planning to send me back to Nigeria and leave me there. On Sunday, we went to Nigeria. Can you imagine how difficult it must have been for a child to be taken from one country and left in another? I was left in Nigeria without any money. It felt like the end of the world. I was confused. I cried every single day. After 1 year in Nigeria, I was told I could come back. Before coming to England, my aunt said that if I refused to come back, I'd be left there to suffer without any help. They paid for my plane ticket, but my passport was not given to me. Before coming to England, both my aunt and her husband promised me that when we came back, I would not have to stay with them, that they would rent an apartment for me and help me look for a job so that I'd be able to help myself. In 2011, when I came back, things got worse for me. Things were back like before. On the 2nd of May 2012, I escaped. I was referred to an organisation called Afruka to help get physical and emotional support and help to find housing. This organisation, that I'm still involved with today, helped me with my confidence and to learn how to be independent. Since I've been with this organisation, I've been able to attend classes, able to do things myself, the opportunity for which I've never had before. I was particularly helped by one woman. I told this lady about my difficulties, the abuse and violence I suffered on an almost daily basis. She took me to the police, and the social services were also involved again. I told them about what happened, but ultimately both the police and social services said, "We're sorry, there's nothing we can do because you're no longer a child." I stayed with this lady and eventually she referred me to a man at Stepping Stones, who put me in touch with Afruka, who helped me find accommodation and support.